Well, thank you all for coming. As Don said, I'm Lori Cragen. I'm an associate professor at Old Dominion University in the Counseling and Human Services program. So I wanted to start out this presentation how I always do. I always talk when I give this presentation about how I got started in the field of self-injury and self-injury research. And so it started, like Don said, about 10 years ago. And what's unique about today is that the person it got started with is right in front of us, Steve Gallus. And Steve was my intern about 10, I was Steve's intern about 10 years ago. I was an intern in Williamsburg, James City County Schools. And Steve came to me one day and said that he had a client or a student that he wanted me to work with. And Steve always liked to give me challenges. And he said this student was particularly difficult. I think I remember him saying she was probably the most difficult student in the school. And immediately, I was terrified as he told me more about her. And one of the things he told me about her was that she was cutting herself and had a history of self-injury. And so I remember leaving that day from my day at Williamsburg James City County Schools, and I went to Barnes & Noble, and I tried to check out and buy as many books as I could on self-injury. And I remember sitting in the backyard just trying to read as much as I can on it. And I remember sitting with that young girl that first day, and I was overwhelmed with the amount of pain that she was in. It was fascinating to me that a lot of the treatment she received in the past was not adequate to her standards. And so at that point forward, I made a commitment to her and to anyone else that I was going to try to learn as much as I could on the topic. And so I thank Steve for being that spark plug into my research and self-injury. So it started 10 years ago, and it's continued on today, where I do more research and I do more conversations and writings on self-injury. And so I wanted to start out with a quote from the first book I read by Steve Levenkron. It's called Cutting. And Levenkron says that self-injury involving cutting, burning, etc., can be seen as a symbolic way of expressing deep distress, a nonverbal form of communication in which the feelings are externalized through the body, where they can be dealt with in a more visible way. Yet, because of its very disability, self-injury is often treated with mistrust and fear. And it's really those last two words that have motivated me, because the majority of the clients and students I've worked with in the past have really spoke to that. And so, again, that's the impetus for this type of research. Lots of different definitions about self-injury out there. There's really no universal definition. One of the definitions I came up with some of the doc students at Old Dominion University was that self-inflicting bodily harm, or self-injury is self-inflicting bodily harm of a socially unacceptable nature performed to reduce some sort of psychological distress. We'll talk more about this definition as we go through in the next hour or so. So why should we focus on the problem? Lots of fancy statistics out there, but a lot of the statistics that we have are from emergency room settings. And so when you think about the clients or the students you've worked with, many of them may have never walked through an emergency room door. And so we really have no idea about the magnitude of self-injury in our society today. I did cite a recent study in 2012. A lot of the research in the past has been done on adolescents. So adolescence is kind of the main area we've looked at. But research is beginning to look at that younger age group. And so the research says that 7.6% of third graders had intentionally hurt themselves compared to 4% of sixth graders, and then an increase again at ninth grade with 12.7%. So that's a newer area that the research is going into, and I think if some of y'all are working with that younger age group, you may be beginning to see increases in that population as well. I wanted to add to the presentation where self-injury is with the DSM-5. Some of you already may know this, but the DSM-5 came out in May 2013. And there was a big excitement because everyone was talking about how self-injury was going to be in the DSM-5. It didn't quite work out, I think, the way that some people thought it was going to work out. But non-suicidal self-injury, or NSSI, in the past, in the DSM-4, was a criteria for borderline personality disorder or stereotypic movement disorder. Well, now it's in Section 3 of the DSM-5. Conditions for future study, which is really not a reimbursable criteria or diagnosis at this point, but what they're saying is that we want to learn more about it, and so it's in the back of the DSM-5. It's also written as a V code in the DSM-5 currently, which some people say, well, you know, stay away from V codes because you can't get reimbursed, but you can get reimbursed for some V codes with a lot of insurance companies. The criteria in the DSM-5 right now, I know you all can read, but what it says is that the individual for 5 or more days has engaged in intentional self-inflicted damage to the surface of his or her body of a sort likely to induce bleeding, bruising, or pain, with the expectation that the injury will only lead to minor or moderate physical harm. So 5 or more days, then the individual engaging in the self-injurious behavior has to have one or more of the following. They have to seek relief from a negative feeling, either to resolve an interpersonal difficulty and to induce a positive state. So that's the B criteria. There's a few more criteria that the behavior has to be associated with one or more of the following, an interpersonal difficulty or negative feelings and thoughts. Prior to engaging in the act, a period of reoccupation with the intended behavior. Thinking about self-injury that occurs frequently, even when it's not acted upon. And then D, E, and F. D says it's the behavior is not socially sanctioned behavior, like body piercing and tattooing. We'll talk a little bit about that. And the behavior or its consequences cause clinically significant distress. And then the behavior does, not DOE, does not occur exclusively during psychotic episodes, delirious, substance intoxication, or substance withdrawal. So I just wanted to give you all that. Some of you all already know this, but it's a newer thing right now with the self-injury research. Lots of people are talking about where it is with the DSM-5. Some interesting conversations about it. Some people are really happy about it, that it's not considered a mental disorder, and other people would like to see it listed as a mental disorder. So there's certainly lots of conversation about it. Okay, so what do we know? What we know a lot of things about self-injury. We know a lot about the statistics. We know a lot about describing the behavior. But what we really don't know is what is the best approach to work with individuals who self-injure. We do know that a majority of the people that seek help are dissatisfied with the treatment that they receive or have received. Many individuals feel like their treatment providers have failed to understand them and judge them for their behaviors. And many fear that they will have consequences for revealing their self-injury, no matter what context they may be in. A recent conversation not too long ago was with a young girl who told me one of her treatment providers in Virginia refused to see her again because she continued to self-harm. And I was just floored by that, by her telling me that. But these are the things that are happening with some of our treatment providers. So how do we respond? I know when I first started working with individuals who self-injure, it made my stomach turn. And it was frightening, especially when somebody lifts up their arm and shows you the extent of the cuts and wounds and scars on their arms. And so I think one of the main things is what I said at the bottom is helper, know thyself. To spend a lot of time thinking about processing, talking to others about your own reactions, your own stereotypes and feelings about this behavior. It's not uncommon that we may pathologize this behavior. Years ago, self-injury was only viewed as a symptom of someone who is extremely psychotic or with someone with borderline personality disorder. And what we know now, that's really not the case. And I'll talk more about that. Okay, so when we think about self-injury, this is kind of the difficult thing to talk about, is how are people harming themselves? And so what we know is most people are cutting themselves. So 70 to 90% of individuals are cutting themselves with some sort of sharp instrument. But self-injury also can include another range of umbrella behaviors like scratching, those individuals who will continue repetitively scratch themselves. Self-hitting, worked with one young woman who every time she went by a light post, one of the ones out there, she would bang her arm against the light post. Headbanging, you may see this more with individuals with developmental delays or autism. Burning, I work with one young woman who she started cutting, but she couldn't quite get the same relief, so she began to burn the tips of her fingers. When you think about the tips of your fingers, probably one of the most sensitive parts of your body. Interference with wound healing or inserting objects under the skin. These are things that inserting objects under the skin in extreme forms we don't see as often, but we do see. Extreme forms of self-injury would include bone breaking, limb amputation, and eye enucleation, removing the eyeball, which is usually associated with extreme psychosis or drug-induced psychosis. Yeah, and that would be biting yourself, scratching yourself. Mm-hmm. Definitely. So what are the tools individuals use? Most often, individuals may use a knife or razor blade. It took me a long time, I think probably because I'm so naive, is to figure out how individuals were cutting themselves with a razor blade. But they typically just took a disposable razor blade and took the razor out. And then it was very easy to use because it was portable. One young woman I work with, her parents owned a knife and gun shop. She had a really contentious relationship with her parents, and so she would use the knives on display in the knife and gun shop to harm herself. Scissors, one young woman said that scissors are the most difficult mode of self-injury, but the most rewarding because it took that much effort and precision to get that cut that she needed. Safety pins, we see a lot of that in the schools or in inpatient settings because they're easy to hide. And one of the middle schools, not too long ago, there was a phenomenon of the young kids having these safety pin, I think, bracelets to kind of walk around as a signal of solidarity that they were all in this together. Broken glass and bottles, I work with this one young woman and her family was really on top of things, but one way they responded to her self-injury was to remove every sharp object in the house. Knives, razors, everything. So she would go for a walk and find a bottle on the ground, a broken bottle, and she would use that to harm herself. Fingernails is probably one of the most extreme wounds I've seen is from a young man who would cut himself with his own fingernails. So when you're thinking about self-injury, it's just important to realize how and what and to be able to have these types of conversations without having a personal reaction. If you're asking your clients, well, tell me about how you harm yourself and tell me about the tools that you use. I included this quote. It says that scars have the strange power to remind us that the past is real. The thing about self-injury is when using these tools, the reminders are on their body forever for most people. And so that can be a really difficult thing for individuals to move past if that reminder is always there with them. When we talk about who's self-injuring, demographics are certainly changing. And when we talk about demographics, it's really where the research has focused. And so be careful not to make that assumption that 3 to 4 times right now, it says 3 to 4 times more common in women than men. Well, maybe so, but also the research has been done mainly with women. And so we also see with men that self-injury may manifest itself differently. They may not report it as readily. So this statistic is very debatable. With race and ethnicity, same thing. Really targeted white, middle-class, adolescent females. I do think it is very high in that population, but we also haven't really fully explored in other racial and ethnic groups. With ages, early adolescence is usually when we see the behavior starting, but with the recent research study in the Journal of Pediatrics, we saw that early onset is beginning a little bit earlier, with children at 6 and 7 who are beginning to show signs of self-injury. Yes? I think it would be inclusive of all those types of behaviors, but it would have to be not just an individual or young child who's just picking a little bit. It would have to be pretty substantial, according to this current research study. And additional characteristics, what we know is that many individuals who harm themselves have a pretty high level of intelligence. They're pretty able. They have a high ability to intellectualize what they're experiencing. They also may have a high relationship, and I don't use the word comorbidity. I got in trouble for that in a journal because it's not in the DSM-4 yet as a mental disorder, so you can't use the word comorbidity. You have to say relationship. You learn something new every day. So a high relationship with depression, anxiety disorders, personality disorders. Eating disorders are beginning. Some people conceptualize eating disorders as a form of self-injury as well. And substance abuse. So again, this is an umbrella way of conceptualizing self-injury. And so some people are of the belief that all of these behaviors listed are a type of self-injury. That's really up to you in terms of how you want to diagnose or categorize self-injury. Impulse-related disorders, I think, is an interesting thing to look at. We see a lot of individuals who self-injure that may be self-injuring not maybe because they have these deep-seated issues that they're working with, but that may be more related to some sort of impulse-related disorder. Okay, so the million-dollar question, you know, when I first started doing this research, was people would ask me, why? Why do people do this? There's really no quick answer to this. There's lots of reasons why people self-injure. I look at it as an interplay between psychology, biology, and the environment. And so in the next little section here, I'm going to share some quotes from a research study I did from women who talk about their experiences with self-injury through each one of these lenses, biological, psychological, and environmental. So psychologically based reasons for self-injuring. Some of y'all know some of these already, but individuals who self-injure may be using physical pain to ward off the emotional pain, right? So the physical pain, or the emotional pain rather, is so intense that they'd rather have that physical pain, right? So they would prefer to have any sort of physical pain than that emotional pain. There may be individuals who have an interpersonal vulnerability or deficits in emotion-related skills, so the inability to express their emotions. We'll talk more about that. The inability to express feelings verbally. The bottom quote says, some people cry, I cut myself. I thought this was a really powerful quote to show that this is how I'm expressing myself. Some people can get it out with their tears or their emotions, but I can't, and so I cut myself. One woman said the pain inside was so much and I didn't want to talk about it, so it was just easier to cut and feel some sort of physical manifestation of the emotional pain. Individuals who self-injure also have a poor ability to tolerate these negative states that they're in, which definitely has some direct implications for treatment. So individuals who may be experiencing high levels of anxiety or depression or anger, they can't sit with that feeling for very long. They have a low tolerance for it, and so they turn to self-injury to stop that feeling from happening. Lots of individuals who self-injure are suppressing these thoughts too, and they're coming out not in a surprising way, but they may be coming out in the form of self-injury. Obviously, self-injury is a coping mechanism, right? It's they're coping with their behaviors, but it's obviously an ineffective coping mechanism. One woman said, I didn't have any control in my life, and self-injury was the only way to exercise some kind of command over what was happening to me. I use caution when saying it's all about control or it's all about an ineffective coping mechanism. I think that really simplifies why people self-injure, but it is true to some level. One woman said that cutting was a coping behavior, but she would switch behaviors. So if she stopped cutting, she would stop smoking or drinking. Or when her eating disorder was at its peak, her cutting was at its lowest point. And conversely, when she recovered from the eating disorder, the cutting got worse. I'll explain this more because this has some direct implications for treatment as well. One young woman I work with had an inability to express feelings towards her mother. So every time she'd pick up the phone to call her mother would hang up the phone on her. She never was able to express those feelings towards her mother. And so cutting became that form of expression for her. Or could be that unconscious desire to inflict pain on a particular person. So if they can't express that anger or hurt somebody else, they may do it through their own body. Or to punish oneself. One young woman had cheated on her boyfriend, and she felt so awful about it that she felt that she deserved to have some sort of pain that would mirror the pain that he felt. And so she cut herself to punish herself for that. Other psychological reasons, poor problem-solving abilities, that's not a real surprising one. A release, this statement really haunts me from one particular woman. She said, seeing my own blood was a rush for me. That sounds gross, but seeing my blood trickle down my leg felt really good to me. It felt empowering, it felt dangerous, and it gave me a rush and a feeling almost like playing God. That's a little extreme, but and so basically I would let it bleed and watch it, and I'd be like, wow, this is intense. This is an 18-year-old girl. Her intellectual ability, her level of insight, I think is pretty impressive. But that she was able to look at self-injury in this through this lens of a release for her, where she was in control. It can also be a period when those emotions get so big for an individual. If someone can harm themselves, it allows them to ground themselves. So if they can focus just on this little pain on their arm or a little pain on their leg, it's that much more manageable. So it can kind of ground somebody and bring them back to reality in some ways. I did talk a little bit earlier about control. This is an older study, but I like to use it because we talk about self-injury is all about control. But when you talk to people, many of them will say they have no control over the act at all. So what does that mean? If it's all about control and the individuals don't have any control over it, maybe we need to look at it through a different lens. Some individuals may harm themselves for attention, right? So they may not be the person who comes in your office or your clinic or your school hiding it. They may flaunt it and show you it, and they may want you to see it. They may want a reaction from you. Does that mean we don't pay attention to them? No, if somebody's trying to get that attention, I'm going to give it to them. And I'll talk a little bit about that too. I want to just talk one more thing about the psychological. Steve Levenkron in his book, he has a great metaphor that really helped me to understand self-injury when I first started out. He talked about a young girl, or anybody really, walking on a beach, walking their dog on a beach, but in the winter times, so it's really cold. And you're walking on the beach and you look out in the horizon and you see someone drowning. And you run out, you just respond. You run out into that water and you try to save that person. You don't stop and say, oh my goodness, it's so cold out. Maybe I should have worn something warmer. You just go. You just go and that adrenaline is so much that you don't feel that pain of that cold water. And that's the same with self-injury. The emotions are so much that some of them don't even feel the physical pain. A lot of the individuals I work with don't feel that physical pain. I use that a little bit in my treatment approaches, and we'll talk a little bit about that too. So that was like the fastest explanation of psychological reasons, but just a little bit of overview for you. So now we look a little bit at the biological reasons for why someone would self-injure. This is a newer area we're looking into, where people are starting to see that there are physiological antecedents and consequences which may instigate the behavior. So some things that are happening in the body before and after the act of self-injury that may make it difficult for somebody to stop. You may have had a student or client say, honestly, I really don't want to do this anymore. I'm kind of over it, but I can't stop, and I don't know why. And so if you see that happening, there may be something happening on a physiological level with that client. Not surprising that higher levels of serotonin may be lower in those who self-injure. That's why we see some benefit from individuals on antidepressants who are self-injuring. Not a surprise because of the high relationship with depression or anxiety. We also see this this thing called enkephalines. Their role is to suppress pain and regulate emotion. They have a pleasurable effect, and so individuals who harm themselves may get a bit of that pleasurable effect, that adrenaline, when they harm themselves. What's scary about that, which many of you know, is that in order to get that feeling, you may have to do it more frequently, you may have to do it more intensely. Where we see a lot of individuals who really may not want to harm themselves to the point of suicide, but they may by accident because they're not getting that same relief. They have to go deeper. They have to be more extreme. We also see that genetics plays a role. There is some research to show that some individuals may have a genetic predisposition towards high emotional or cognitive reactivity. Okay. Any questions on the psychological or biological influences? Talk a little bit about environment here. There's strong correlations between childhood physical and sexual abuse. Up to 79% of those who self-injure report a history of child abuse. This is definitely something that we need to pay attention to and be aware of, but also use caution. Oprah did a story on self-injury not long ago. I do love Oprah. But the message was that I took away from it was that everybody who self-injures has been abused in some sort of way, and that's not true. So just to use some caution, but there is a high relationship with abuse and self-injury. Also with parental drug or alcohol abuse, a real or perceived lack of support. If you work with adolescents in particular, if they perceive it to be true, it's true, right? So they may have, from most standards, a pretty good relationship with their parent, but if they don't perceive it to be so, then it's not so. So I see that a lot. I see individuals who've experienced loss or a recent trauma move to self-injury. Many may just simply have friends who self-injure. One woman said, I had a lot of friends that did it, a lot of girlfriends, and so I guess it seemed normal because a lot of my friends were very smart girls, so I thought it must be kind of normal for smart girls to cut themselves. That's just how the other girls in her school were coping, and so why not? And really, until later in her life, until maybe her first year in college, did she realize that really probably wasn't an accurate assumption to make. But in her world, it was very normal. It's very much a learned behavior, as I said. One young girl said, I don't think I would have cut myself if I hadn't heard about it. In class, we read a book that talked about girls with problems, and so this young woman said, well, I'm a girl with problems, and I was like, this is what people do when they have problems. I guess in a way I wanted to do something to be like, I'm really depressed, rather than talking about it. So if somebody harms themselves, you can see it. They don't have to explain to you that they're struggling. They don't have to come up to you and have this deep, intense discussion. They can just show you, and it's a reason. The book, in fact, was Reviving Ophelia that she started to cut from. It's a great book, and clearly the teacher had no idea that this was going to come from it. But it does show you just never know, and really important to spend a lot of time processing when you're using emotionally charged books like this. But at the other hand, we're talking about the USA Network, family-friendly. You may have kids and say, oh, great, you know, let's watch the USA Network. At least we did when we were younger. In fact, I don't even know if it's still in existence, the USA Network, but it was a family-friendly network. But there was a show on it, kind of like those the TLC show, the soap opera thingies. But this one was called Secret Cutting. It was for teenagers, and she got the idea from that show, and she said she tried it and it was magic. That's another quote that really sticks with me. She tried it and it was magic. It worked for her. It spoke to her. Other individuals may self-injure just to fit in. We talked a little bit about the young individuals who had the paper clips. They just want to fit in. Or maybe they just want to stand out. They want to be different. They want to be heard. They want attention. And so while some may do it to stand out, some may do it to fit in. Okay, I'm just going to go through these four questions and then we'll take a break. These are four questions that I see a lot in the literature, that I see a lot in discussions with people, or people ask me questions, so I thought I'd highlight them. One is, can self-injury be addictive? We're in a perfect place to have this type of discussion. Is self-injury different than suicide? Are piercings and tattoos typical of self-injury? And is the individual who flaunts his or her wounds a phony? So, addictive qualities. In my work and over the years, it's been really interesting to me to start to view self-injury through the lens of an addiction. Not for everybody, but for some individuals, we see this happening. We see that there's a strong biological and psychosocial influence to self-injury. We see that self-injury can be a form of self-medication. You know, if they can just focus on this pain in their arm, they don't have to deal with anything else that's going on. Many describe a craving for the behavior. Worked with this one young woman, she's 25. She's been struggling on and off with self-injury for years. She can feel it coming on. She'll move away from the behavior for a while. She'll feel it coming on. It's in her thoughts repetitively, compulsively, until the point where she can't control that urge anymore, and she'll have to self-injure. But once she self-injures, she has relief. And so, again, that really mimics, when we look at addiction, that really mimics when we think of other addictions, whether we look at process addictions or substance abuse addictions. Relapse is common. I use this a lot with my work with individuals who self-injure, because some of them may not cut for 3 months and 4 months, and they just think they're on a great path. Their parents come in, they think you're the best clinician in the world. They're so happy with you. And the adolescent or the adult comes in and they harm themselves and they're devastated. Their parents are off the wall, scared, obviously. But I don't look at that as a negative step in the wrong direction. It's very much a part of the process of recovery with self-injury. What we focus on with relapse is, okay, you cut yourself again. Let's talk about this time versus the times you did it before. How'd you feel before and after? And this one woman said to me, well, it hurt like hell this time. It never used to hurt. I don't know what that's about. I don't want to do this again for a long time. And so that, to me, was progress. And not so much the celebrate's a strong word, but I highlighted that with her as progress. Because before, it was a totally different experience. And you normalize that relapse. And you talk about that with the family members as well. So they don't have that expectation that once they stop, they're stopping forever. Or that once they start again, they have failed. So I think that's one of the biggest things that's helped me in my work with individuals. And it's funny, when they walk in, they may have their head down, feeling terrible about themselves, but they walk out feeling like, okay, I can do this. Maybe it's not the worst thing in the world. We also see, like I said before, that buildup of tolerance over time and the role of different neurotransmitters and endorphins. So when you think about this, you don't want to assume everybody fits into this model, but just start to conceptualize it from that viewpoint. It can be really helpful in your work with individuals. The relationship between self-injury and suicide, this is probably the most common question that I receive. Is self-injury and suicide the same thing? A lot of the research right now shows them as two separate and distinct behaviors. They want to separate them. I think that's really dangerous. not to say that everybody who self-injures is a risk to themselves to commit suicide, but I think it's something we have to be aware of. The majority of the research makes these stark distinctions, but 50 to 75% of individuals who self-injured have made at least one suicide attempt in the past. And an individual who self-injures is 18 times more likely than the rest of the population to eventually commit suicide. Well, why is that? Is that because the tolerance builds up? Is there other reasons? Are there other reasons for that? I'm not quite sure, but it's important that we recognize there's an overlap. I look at self-injury and suicide on a continuum, with self-injury being on one end of the continuum of a self-harming behavior, and suicide attempts or suicide behaviors being on the other end of the spectrum. Of course, the intent behind every act is different, but with each and every act, it's important that we examine that, each and every one, that we don't assume that this client, oh, they're just self-injuring. They don't have an intention to kill themselves. Make sure you know that for sure with each and every new act of self-injury. Mm-hmm. And you also spend some time, too, on safety precautions and things like that. Because like I said, some people may harm themselves with the intent just to have release or relief, but they may hit a major artery or they may cause more damage than they expected to themselves. Tattooing and piercings, are they the same as self-injury? This is kind of a funny story, at least I think it's funny, is that I work with this young woman, and she stopped self-injuring, so I thought I was, because I was on a good track record, I thought I was, the best therapist to treat self-injury because they were all stopping. But I wasn't paying attention to the other things that were happening, like the other coping behaviors, but this was one of them, is that one young woman, she stopped cutting. Great, but then she started to get her own tattoos. She would self-tattoo, or she would pierce without, the ice cubes. She would just go right through. I had one young man who would take these long poles. I don't really know what they were, but they were circular, and he would stick them up through his nose and put it on YouTube to try to get some sort of response, reaction from people. In an attempt to get famous. His parents thought he was delusional. But really, when you look at shows like Jackass or other things like that are out there, people do get famous for doing some things like that. I'm not sure if his intent was truly related to symptom relief or not, but that was happening. So it's important to look at intent. If you see somebody who is getting tattoos or piercings, what's the intent behind it? Is it artistic expression, or is there something else going on? What about frequency? Are they getting, all of a sudden you see this one adolescent or adult that every week they come in with a new piercing? Is that an artistic expression, or is that something more? And consider modes. Again, are they doing it on their own? Are they doing it without Novocaine or anesthesia? And just pay attention to that. I certainly didn't at the beginning, and I think I missed out on some important things. And lastly, is the individual who flaunts their self-injury a phony? So I have a lot of parents I've talked with, and they come in and say, she is just doing it for attention. It's the most obnoxious behavior I've ever seen. And I say to them, and she could kill herself for attention too. Right? And so just because they're doing it for attention doesn't mean that we don't pay attention to it. If somebody wants that attention, give it to them. And I really believe strongly about that. You really can't fake self-injury. Cutting yourself, harming yourself is real, causes real pain. It's not something you can fake. And again, the intention behind it is different. The way that you work with an individual is different based on whether they're hiding it or flaunting it, but we still need to pay attention to that. So those were just some four common things. And I want to take a break, and then the next half hour, we'll just talk about things that you can do to work with individuals who self-injure. Okay. So I wanted to talk a little bit about working with individuals who self-injure. So we'll go over these four points and then talk a little bit more specifically about some interventions. So four things I just wanted to touch on, which you could spend maybe an hour on each one, but we're just going to spend a minute or so on each one. So understanding your audience, the ethics related to self-injury work, what to avoid, and then a general approach or philosophy. It's important that we understand the audience that you're working with in terms of a philosophy of approach. The majority of those who are seeking treatment may be referred by others, so they might not want, they likely don't want to be talking to you. And so it's important to recognize that. They also may be manipulating to the extent that they may be hiding a lot of their self-injury for lots of different reasons, shame, embarrassment. And so to be aware of that, but not to assume that. This quote has stuck with me, and one girl said that she started cutting in order to get the help she needed. I remember thinking that I wished I could get rape so that I could go to counseling. I think this is one of the main reasons I started cutting, was because I felt I needed counseling. And so that to me is a very alarming quote. I think it's not isolated. I think it's probably representative of the fact that many people see that barrier to receiving help. They don't know how to ask for it. They don't know how to access it. But if they have a legitimate reason, it makes it a little bit easier. And I don't want that for them, and I know that you all don't want that for them. But it is a really powerful, powerful quote to me. In terms of ethics, the big question is duty to warn. So is there a harm to self with self-injury? What does harm to self mean, especially when you're working with minors? So considering the age, is it different when you're working with a minor? In some contexts, yes. In most contexts, yes. In some contexts, maybe not. With every self-injuring act, of course, it's important to assess suicidality. So if there is at all a risk of suicidal behaviors or suicidal attempts, then of course there'd be a duty to warn. But what if it's just normal self-injuring behavior for symptom relief or to feel something? Do we break confidentiality? And again, this is something I could really just talk for a long time with, because there's no right answer to the gray area that exists with self-injury. It's important to weigh the risks and the benefits all the time, though. So a professional working with a client, you may be in legal jeopardy. If you know that your client's self-injuring, especially your client is a minor, they walk away from your session, you know it, you've been documenting it, and they kill themselves. So we need to be aware that I think we live in an age where liability drives a lot, and I don't necessarily think that's a good thing, but it just is. And so we need to pay attention to that. Will breaking confidentiality make it worse for your client? And sometimes, yes, it will. And so if that's the case, is it important to keep that confidence with your client? It's important, too, with context. In school settings, we may be required to break confidentiality more so than a community setting. Does your school agency clinic have a protocol? If they have a protocol, which they should, if they have a suicide protocol, it makes sense if you had a self-injury protocol, but most agencies don't have a self-injury protocol. So if you want to get brownie points or things like that with your boss, or if you're the boss, if you want to kind of be on the cutting edge, that would be something to do, is to create this protocol. And have you communicated your stance on confidentiality with your client? And once you do that from the beginning, you just go from that point on. And so whatever that stance is, make sure you communicate it from the beginning. Also, when you're looking at whether or not to break confidentiality, it's important to look at it through a medical lens. So looking at the extent of the wounds, do they require medical attention? It's a no-brainer. We break confidentiality. And always, always, always seek supervision and consultation, because you might be looking at it from one perspective, but when you talk with a colleague, they may bring up a whole other thing that you hadn't thought about. And so never, if you have a client, you're not quite sure about what to do, always seek supervision. I developed this little chart to kind of help us with understanding, okay, what does danger to self mean? So maybe we need to look at the extent of physical harm and the extent of psychological harm. And so if your client is at the less severe end of both areas of psychological and physical harm, maybe we have a lower need to break confidentiality. As you move forward on that continuum of psychological and physical behaviors, if they kind of come together, or if one of them is more extreme than the others, then it's a sure deal in terms of breaking confidentiality. In terms of what to avoid, I know all of you probably already do this, but number one would be to refrain from judgment, to not scold the student or the client for self-injuring. I was just talking with somebody over in the middle there about, she had a client as well who was refused treatment when she continued to self-injure. So that it can get frustrating, though. You put so much time and effort into your clients, and they come back, and you think you're making progress, and you know, we take a backward step. It can get frustrating, but important not to scold, especially educate families on that as well. Don't let your own feelings get in the way. Avoiding no harm contracts. This is my stance, and certainly not the stance of everybody. When you ask a client to stop self-injuring and you don't replace it with another coping behavior, you can be setting yourself up for something more severe. A colleague of mine had a client of hers. She followed the no harm contract. She stopped cutting, but she started to swallow shards of glass. So check off the list. She did what she was asked to, because she's a good student. She's a good client. She's going to do what she was asked. But she went to something more extreme. So you have to realize that's potential when you have no harm contracts. Now, and some of them said that it's a joke. I've heard clients say, this is a joke, I'll sign, sure, no problem. And then you have clients who will stop because they want to impress you or they feel guilty. And while that might be good in the short term, we want them to stop for themselves. So we don't want them to stop out of guilt or out of pleasing you. So we want to have long-term success. I believe in no-harm contracts when you set them up with the client, work together, and you write things like, when I feel like I'm going to harm myself, I will contact so-and-so, or I will do this. Not, I will not harm myself between now and the next time I come see you. I encourage you to move away from that type of no-harm contract. Sometimes, depending on your agency, though, you may have to do those types of no-harm contracts for liability reasons. Just realize it may not be a long-term result that you're looking for. Avoid characterizing your clients as cutters. Your clients will do this. I'll talk a little bit about that. They may say, I'm a cutter, you know, first time you meet them. You may work with colleagues and say, oh, do you have that cutter today? Or, you know, you working with any cutters lately? Just to avoid doing that. And avoid an expert stance. All of the majority of the clients I interviewed for this study viewed their experiences as negative when their counselor set their direction of the session, conveyed the idea that they had all the answers, and often talked down to them. So a lot of the clients in this research study wanted a collaborative approach, which is more consistent with some a narrative approach, a feminist approach, a Rogerian approach to treatment. Be cautious of behavioral approaches. And this is my stance as well, and some people disagree on this too. You may have heard people talk about using ice cubes or elastic bands so that they won't cut themselves or harm themselves. That's a good short-term answer. But what it does in the person's mind, it still fuses emotional pain with physical pain in that schema. And so we want to make that association move apart. So when someone feels emotional pain, we don't want the next thing in their head to pop up as, I want physical pain. And so those things do that. The ice cubes and the elastic bands still make that fusion. And I think if you want long-term results, you don't want to do these approaches. For the short term, they do work. Also remember that behavioral approaches focus only on the outward symptoms. The visible wounds, not the underlying symptoms. And when you work with self-injury, the only way you really can get long-term success and results is when you focus on what's beneath the wounds and not to focus extensively on the wounds. One of the clients I work with in the study said, all this counselor or therapist or clinician wanted to do was talk to me about my cuts. And honestly, I wanted to talk about a lot more things than just the cuts on my arms. And so it was like the client felt like the therapist wasn't getting to know them beyond their wounds. And so I think also within terms of philosophy, I've heard this time and time again that the majority of people coming through my office feel like they're crazy. And so it's important to normalize the behavior with them. Many feel ashamed, embarrassed, guilty based on their behaviors. And so it's very critical that you create an atmosphere free of judgment. And to realize that it takes time, it takes an enormous amount of patience. Avoid expectations for a quick recovery. And in fact, if you see a quick recovery, it may not necessarily be a good thing. And create a forum for voices to be heard. That's the foundation of my work, is that we need to create a foundation for their voices to be heard. And we need to teach them how to do that, too. Yeah.
When it comes to normalizing, how do you go about normalizing that behavior? How do you teach them?
You have to be careful not to to say that the behavior is okay and that there's nothing wrong with it. But I think to also let them know that they're not crazy. There's nothing deep-seated or wrong about them, but they've chosen to use a coping skill that's worked for them, but it's not healthy. So let's try to find something that's healthy for you. That's what I mean by normalizing. Mm-hmm. Good question. Okay, so just some interventions in the next 50 minutes or so. I don't want to spend too much time on theory because that can get really boring, especially after y'all ate a little bit. But I like to bring in, I kind of rely on three different theories in my work. A cognitive behavioral approach. Lots of the clients you work with, they have these thoughts that are going through their head. Most of them delusional, negative, but they have a profound effect on their behavior. And so we spend a lot of time with these thoughts and self-talk strategies, very successful strategies to use when you're working with a client. A narrative approach has been really, really important to me in my work. When you help a client share their story and then redefine it. So again, with the narrative approach, this focuses on externalizing someone's problems in an effort to discuss them from an outside perspective. And so what you'll see a lot of the time is your client's going to define themselves as a cutter, as if they are the problem. They are the same thing as the problem is. And so what you want to do is help them to view their problem from the external stance of them. Okay, I'm not a cutter, but again, I've chosen some of these behaviors in the past. They've worked for me, but I want to try something different. So that really comes from a narrative approach. And then the Rogerian approach or Adlerian approach looks at that relationship and the influence of the environment and the family. So again, just wanted to touch base on those. When you meld all these theories together, I look at it from four different steps on building the relationship, investigating the phenomenon, interpreting, making sense of what's happening, and then reorienting, creating a new story and new steps towards making changes.
What's your thoughts about journaling? Not really telling a story, but today I felt like it, and so I documented how I was feeling, the antecedents.
Perfect. I think that's great. And for some clients, and I'll talk a little bit about that in a few minutes, but it works like magic for them because they're externalizing, they're processing, and then they can bring it into the session and you can work with that. For some people, they'll look at you and say, that's stupid, I hate to write, I don't want to do that. But for the client who likes to write, it's perfect. Mm-hmm. So number one thing is establishing rapport. I was so struck by the study that I did because I thought people were going to say some really fancy things, powerful things that were going to help me create this model for treatment. And really when it came down to it, it was about the relationship. It was about trust. It was about working together. It was kind of like a partnership. It was a partnership of the two of us against the cutting. Like one young woman viewed her work with her therapist that way. As your knowledge grows, don't assume you know everything. I think that was my downfall in the beginning. I thought, oh, I can just keep getting all this information, and I'm really having good success, and I think I'm really good at it. And then I realized I really don't know but just this much about the topic. So that's been helpful. just to spend time as you create a forum for voices to be heard, to listen, to let people tell you their story. A lot of them talked about wanting a friendship. Now, of course, this doesn't mean friendship in the sense of how you how we define friends, like in the dictionary. So it doesn't mean like going out for coffee and going to the movies and things like that. But having that relationship where they saw you as that friend-like in that session. Having compassion, again, it's really hard not to when you really think about the level of pain that these clients have, to have that level of compassion and to not forget about that, because like we've talked about, it can get so frustrating. And sometimes these clients just pick at your nerve, and you look at the schedule or you see the appointments or who's coming in, and you're, oh no, not this person again. This is going to take every last ounce of energy that I have. But to remember, why they're there, and to remember that amount of pain that they must be in. And again, we'll talk about this now, is learning who your client is beyond their self-injury. When you do assessments, really important in the beginning, I won't go through all of these things, but if you choose to, or if you want the presentation, I can always email it to you. But these are great things to have on an intake when you're doing an initial session with somebody, to ask these sorts of questions about assessment. So looking at frequency, tools, sharing of tools, emotional states, triggers, these are all things you can get in your early work with clients. Also important in terms of assessment is building that developmental history with your client. So because we know that there's that influence of the biology and the environment and the psychology, you want to gain an understanding of what's happening. So you want to gain an understanding of, if you kind of look at it from those three elements of what's happening from each of those perspectives. You want to also explore the major events in the client's life that's led to the behavior. You want to get some background on family of origin, explore histories of mental illness. This really, these last two slides are not really that much of a departure from what you do in the first couple sessions with anyone, other than some specific questions related to self-injury. Gaining knowledge of the client's support systems. I like to do this especially with adolescents because they'll say, I have like 432 friends on Facebook. I have so many friends. I'm just really popular. And then when you sit down and you look at the positive influence of those support systems, or whether those friends, we use the words like interpersonal and intrapersonal. So do you have a real interpersonal relationship with that person? If you have an interpersonal relationship with that person, are you sharing your thoughts and feelings? Are you self-disclosing? Do they know anything about your life beyond what's on your front page profile? So helping them to understand the value of interpersonal relationships. We certainly moved away from that in this age of media, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat. I'm just learning them all. And so spend time looking at that, ask questions to explore. Also, the client's ability to ask for help. That's one of the things we see a deficit in, and so you want to help your clients to learn how to ask for help for you, for their friends, for their family. Focusing on the underlying symptoms is critical. To only view cutting as a symptom, it's only what we see on the outside. So let's focus on what's driving the behavior. And as we talked about with those three elements of psychology, behavior, and environment, there's like a million, maybe not a million, thousands, hundreds of reasons why your client may be self-injuring. Once you find that reason, that's going to drive your treatment. And so to spend as much time as you need to get to that point of finding out that reason or reasons. So that's why you can't really have one treatment path, because it's going to look so different for every individual. One client said, I felt like it was all intertwined, so you shouldn't just have this one goal to stop the outward symptoms when the inward symptoms were just as important. So if that's what our clients are saying to us, I think it's important that we listen to them. Again, when the cutting stops, the problem's not fixed, because they may choose other coping behaviors that are visible or that are not visible, so you'll want to look at that. And like I say, to never rely on the absence or cutting as the only indicator of progress. So so as much as when the cutting stops, the problem is not fixed, but even if they're continuing to cut or harm themselves, progress can still occur. And so, and to focus on that, to celebrate the successes you see, even when they continue to harm themselves. Real more of a positive psychology approach. Using the scars, though, as a tool, so not to, if you just go in and you say, I'm going to focus on the underlying symptoms and you ignore what's happening on the outside, you can miss the boat on that, too. So at times, you may want to use the scars as a tool in your work with clients. And that's been very helpful because, as you know, the scars, they don't go anywhere. They're with that person, unless they have, like, really good skin coloring or healing properties. But ask at the meeting, ask the client whether or not there are any new injuries. Obviously, consider context in school settings. Gender, you may have an effect, too, on whether this is appropriate or not appropriate. So I know in the school systems, the male counselors, male school psychologists working with the young women, this may not be the best approach. But speak the language of the wounds. If your wounds could speak, what would they say about you? Because they're the thing that's doing the communicating. The scars and the wounds are doing the communicating. So what are they saying? And what do they say about you? And what are you feeling before, during, and after? When you look at your scars, what do you think or feel? Just if you look, some scars may be deeper than others, more visible. And you can say, what were you feeling here? Tell me about the feelings that led up to this episode. So to really use that as a tool. Expand feelings vocabulary. As you've seen in some of these quotes, the women, and this was just women that I interviewed, are very intelligent. They can intellectualize with the best of them. But if you say to them, how do you feel today? They might have a vocabulary of maybe 2 or 3 words. And that's not exaggerating. They may know, I feel happy, I feel mad, and I feel sad. But they may not have a very strong feelings vocabulary. I have been amazed at the intelligence level and intellect of some of the people I've worked with, and their emotional intelligence levels are at the opposite end of the spectrum. But the good news about emotional intelligence is that it can be built, and so that's what you're doing with your client, is building that emotional intelligence. And so develop also a relationship between thoughts and feelings. So they may, on paper, be able to write down 1,000 feeling words, but can they then associate that, can they make that relationship to, I am feeling this because, or I'm feeling this in my body, which signifies that I'm really angry, or which signifies that I'm really anxious. It's amazing that they may just intellectualize those terms, but not be able to understand what they really mean. And so I spend a lot of time on that, making lists, practicing different feelings, doing things that, with again, their intelligence level may seem kind of elementary, where you may look at people's faces on a board and ask about each one of those feelings. But it's amazing what you can get from that. Focus on triggers is a big word to use often. So you want to, when you're looking at the underlying symptoms with clients, you want to figure out what their trigger is. And so when are the times that they seem to self-injure more often? Is it based on relationships? Is it based on times when they're feeling anxious? And when you use the words like triggers, it helps them to begin to identify the warning signs that come before the triggers so that they can see it coming and begin to ask for help. That's been very helpful. Just like we talked about, bringing a journal is a great way to process those triggers. So you were 2 steps ahead of me. That's good. Coping skills, this is obviously huge. A lot of your work is creating new coping skills for the individual and to use that language. So to let them know that, again, their self-injury is a coping skill, let's choose something different. And so some of these things, and you'll practice some of them, your client will look at you like you have 2 heads, or your adolescents will tell you you're lame, or, something like that, because it has to speak to that client. And one of the newer ones I've been doing from this list is the meditation piece. Again, you have to kind of be careful of the context which you work, But I found that a lot of individuals, when their emotions get so big, they choose self-injuring to ground them. And so I teach them in the beginning real elementary ways of meditating, where they sit in a chair with their hands together and they focus on their hands for 2 minutes. And during those 2 minutes, these other thoughts are going to come in and they're going to come out, and just to then refocus back on their hands. So if they can start to do that over time, they practice that daily, 2 minutes, no more in the beginning, that teaches them some emotional control, emotional regulation, rather than using the self-injury to create that for them. I found that to be helpful. Relaxation and imagery also is changing some of those thoughts in their heads. Mantras have been really helpful. With a mantra, we just create something that is going to help soothe them or calm them or bring them back to reality. And so it could be something as simple as I am calm, or I am kind to myself, something that speaks to them. We spend time trying to figure out what that is. And then for the adolescents and children, I create more of a play therapy kind of thing with it, an artistic expression where we draw things and we try to create as many signs throughout their room. For adults, you know, in their visual cue, in their bathroom, where they see these mantras over and over again. And that's been helpful. Music has been great, especially if you want to stay current and cool with your clients. If you have your computer, your laptop, and you ask them to bring in a song that speaks to them. So that's kind of, you obviously want to move towards having discussions with them about their feelings, but if they're not quite there, they may have a song that speaks to them. Let them play it and then discuss with them how they identify with that. And that's been really, really helpful. Sometimes I just draw a line. If you're not very creative, this is a great strategy for you. You just draw a line on a piece of paper. That line signifies their scars. What's above the scars? What do people see when they first meet you? But what's driving under the scars? And through your work, you try to fill that space up with the client. And so your first couple times meeting with them, you may not have anything under there. But then after each session, you can start to fill out what's underneath that scar more. Ask them to draw, depict their relationship with self-injury. That's been really interesting, too. I've gotten some pretty, if you just draw a body for them and then just have them draw their relationship with it, it could be powerful. Family counseling approaches, obviously, from a systems perspective, really important to involve the family. To educate is the big thing with self-injury. To work on family communication, family awareness, to work on developing more meaningful, close relationships, to also create a safety plan with the family in terms of making, within limits, too. So if your client is using lots of razors, and sometimes it's best to have some sort of regulation on that. But again, as my story with the young girl who went out and got her bottle on the floor, broken bottle, they're going to find a way. So just to create a safety plan with the family is helpful. And I wanted to end pretty good on time. I wanted to end with a quote. And this quote is, I don't know if Steve will remember this. This is from a client 10 years ago. She was 14 years old, and she was failing English and doing very poorly in school. And one of the strategies we came up with was asking her to write some poetry. I didn't think she would do it. I really didn't. But it was one of those things I threw out there, and she came in with her journal, and she surprised the heck out of me. Always think about her and wonder how she's doing. So I'll read this poem and end with it, because it shows a positive outlook for self-injury. This was towards the end of our work together, one of the poems that she wrote. It says, I've indulged myself in the worlds of dance, art, music, and literature. I've succeeded in the worlds of history, mathematics, and science. I have given up my childhood for a world of premature responsibility and suffer greatly from it, but from that I've gained a world of knowledge and respect. I have rewarded myself with a world of love, full of friends and family. I have earned and kept to myself the love of a man that I would die without. I have made people mad and made them hate me. I have made people cry from laughter and earned the respect of even enemies. I've made a world of mistakes and bad decisions, but I've made up for them with a single good act of apology. I have lied but never hidden from the truth. I've endured countless deaths and survived my own near-death experiences, yet I still await my 16th birthday. Time may fly, but not fast enough. I cry at the thought of the worlds I've yet to come to, yet to conquer, yet to claim. Looking up, face forward, I await these worlds with a head held high, as if there was any other way to welcome these worlds. Every time I read that, I get goosebumps, and I've read it a million times. And so, you know, I end it again with a looking at self-injury, not from this dark, negative place, but from a place of hope and recovery. So, thank you.